Mr. Noel. By William Somerset Maugham. I was prepared to dislike Max Quilada even before I knew him. The war had just finished, and the passenger traffic in the ocean-going liners was heavy. Accommodation was very hard to get, and you had to put up with whatever the agents chose to offer you. You could not hope for a cabin to yourself, and I was thankful to be given one in which there were only two berths. But when I was told the name of my companion, my heart sank. It suggested closed portholes and the night air rigidly excluded. It was bad enough to share a cabin for 14 days with anyone. I was going from San Francisco to Yokohama. But I should have looked upon it with less dismay if my fellow passenger's name had been Smith or Brown. When I went on board, I found Mr. Quilada's luggage already below. I did not like the look of it. There were too many labels on the suitcases, and the wardrobe trunk was too big. He had unpacked his toilet things, and I observed that he was a patron of the excellent Monsieur Coty, for I saw on the washing stand his scent, his hair wash, and his brilliantine. Mr. Quilada's brushes, ebony with his monogram in gold, would have been all the better for a scrub. I did not at all like Mr. Quilada. I made my way into the smoking room. I called for a pack of cards and began to play patience. I had scarcely started before a man came up to me and asked me if he was right in thinking my name was so-and-so. "I am Mr. Quilada," he added, with a smile that showed a row of flashing teeth, and sat down. "Oh, yes, we're sharing a cabin, I think." "Bit of luck, I call it. You never know who you're going to be put in with. I was jolly glad when I heard you were English. I'm all for us English sticking together when we're abroad, if you understand what I mean." I blinked. "Are you English?" I asked, perhaps tactlessly. "Rather. You don't think I look an American, do you?" "British to the backbone. That's what I am." To prove it, Mr. Quilada took out of his pocket a passport and airily waved it under my nose. King George has many strange subjects. Mr. Quilada was short and of a sturdy build, clean-shaven and dark-skinned, with a fleshy hooked nose and very large lustrous and liquid eyes. His long black hair was sleek and curly. He spoke with a fluency in which there was nothing English, and his gestures were exuberant. I felt pretty sure that a closer inspection of that British passport would have betrayed the fact that Mr. Quilada was born under a bluer sky than is generally seen in England. "What will you have?" he asked me. I looked at him doubtfully. Prohibition was in force, and to all appearances the ship was bone dry. When I am not thirsty, I do not know which I dislike more, ginger ale or lemon squash. But Mr. Quilada flashed an oriental smile at me. "Whiskey and soda, or a dry martini. You have only to say the word." From each of his hip pockets he fished a flask and laid them on the table before me. I chose the martini, and calling the steward, he ordered a tumbler of ice and a couple of glasses. "A very good cocktail," I said. "Well, there are plenty more where that came from, and if you've got any friends on board, you tell them you've got a pal who's got all the liquor in the world." Mr. Quilada was chatty. He talked of New York and of San Francisco. He discussed plays, pictures, and politics. He was patriotic. The Union Jack is an impressive piece of drapery, but when it is flourished by a gentleman from Alexandria or Beirut, I cannot but feel that it loses somewhat in dignity. Mr. Quilada was familiar. I do not wish to put on airs, but I cannot help feeling that it is seemly in a total stranger to put Mr. before my name when he addresses me. Mr. Quilada, doubtless to set me at my ease, used no such formality. I did not like Mr. Quilada. I had put aside the cards when he sat down, but now, thinking that for this first occasion our conversation had lasted long enough, I went on with my game.
"The three on the four," said Mr. Quilada.
There is nothing more exasperating when you are playing patience than to be told where to put the card you have turned up before you have had a chance to look for yourself.
It's coming out. It's coming out, he cried. The tin on the nave.
With rage and hatred in my heart, I finished. Then he seized the pack.
Do you like card tricks?
No, I hate card tricks, I answered.
Well, I'll just show you this one.
He showed me three. Then I said I would go down to the dining room and get my seat at table.
Oh, that's all right, he said. I've already taken a seat for you. I thought that as we were in the same stateroom, we might as well sit at the same table.
I did not like Mr. Collada. I not only shared a cabin with him and ate three meals a day at the same table, but I could not walk round the deck without his joining me. It was impossible to snub him. It never occurred to him that he was not wanted. He was certain that you were as glad to see him as he was to see you. In your own house, you might have kicked him downstairs and slammed the door in his face without the suspicion dawning on him that he was not a welcome visitor. He was a good mixer, and in 3 days knew everyone on board. He ran everything. He managed the sweeps, conducted the auctions, collected money for prizes at the sports, got up quats and golf matches, organized the concert, and arranged the fancy dress ball. He was everywhere and always. He was certainly the best-hated man in the ship. We called him Mr. Know-All, even to his face. He took it as a compliment. But it was at meal times that he was most intolerable. For the bitter part of an hour, then, he had us at his mercy. He was hearty, jovial, loquacious, and argumentative. He knew everything better than anybody else, and it was an affront to his overweening vanity that you should disagree with him. He would not drop a subject, however unimportant, till he had brought you round to his way of thinking. The possibility that he could be mistaken never occurred to him. He was the chap who knew. We sat at the doctor's table. Mr. Collada would certainly have had it all his own way, for the doctor was lazy, and I was frigidly indifferent, except for a man called Ramsay, who sat there also. He was as dogmatic as Mr. Collada, and resented bitterly the Levantine's cocksureness. The discussions they had were acrimonious and interminable. Ramsay was in the American consular service and was stationed at Kobe. He was a great heavy fellow from the Middle West, with loose fat under a tight skin, and he bulged out of his ready-made clothes. He was on his way back to resume his post, having been on a flying visit to New York to fetch his wife, who had been spending a year at home. Mrs. Ramsay was a very pretty little thing, with pleasant manners and a sense of humor. The consular service is ill-paid, and she was dressed always very simply, but she knew how to wear her clothes. She achieved an effect of quiet distinction. I should not have paid any particular attention to her, but that she possessed a quality that may be common enough in women, but nowadays is not obvious in their demeanor. You could not look at her without being struck by her modesty. It shone in her like a flower on a coat. One evening at dinner, the conversation by chance drifted to the subject of pearls. There had been in the papers a good deal of talk about the cultured pearls which the cunning Japanese were making, and the doctor remarked that they must inevitably diminish the value of real ones. They were very good already. They would soon be perfect. Mr. Collada, as was his habit, rushed the new topic. He told us all that was to be known about pearls. I do not believe Ramsay knew anything about them at all, but he could not resist the opportunity to have a fling at the Levantine, and in 5 minutes we were in the middle of a heated argument. I had seen Mr. Collada vehement and voluble before, but never so voluble and vehement as now. At last, something that Ramsay said stung him, for he thumped the table and shouted, "Well, I ought to know what I am talking about. I'm going to Japan just to look into this Japanese pearl business. I'm in the trade, and there's not a man in it who won't tell you that what I say about pearls goes. I know all the best pearls in the world, and what I don't know about pearls isn't worth knowing." Here was news for us,
For Mr. Collada, with all his loquacity, had never told anyone what his business was. We only knew vaguely that he was going to Japan on some commercial errand. He looked round the table triumphantly. They